As you know, we talked to you and me a while ago about the use of atrial tissue structural remodeling as a guide to treat patients with atrial fibrillation. And we have been reporting this for years now on a single-center basis, on an animal model basis, the advantage of knowing the degree of atrial tissue disease or fibrosis before we treat patients with AFib, and what that would mean in terms of patient responding to treatments, risk of stroke, and beyond. And 2009, we initiated a study, a multicenter study, that the idea came in 2009. We started the study end of 2010, a multicenter study where we used the MRI technology developed at the University of Utah to, you know, in a multicenter basis, screen patients before they undergo an ablation of AFib with the hypothesis that the more fibrosis or atrial disease detected in MRI, the less the chance patient will stay in sinus rhythm after the AFib ablation procedure. So practically wanted to correlate the amount of atrial fibrosis or atrial disease in patients with atrial fibrillation to the AFib ablation procedure outcome. So we initiated a multicenter study, 15 centers around the world, Australia, Europe, and the United States. We installed in every center this MRI image processing technology. It's called the Merrick Inc. software. And what we did, we blinded the physician to the data. That's why it's a blinded study, blinded follow-up study. It's a one-year follow-up study, at least a one-year follow-up study. So we have 330 patients recruited into the study from, again, 15 centers around the world, and patients underwent ablation. The majority of them underwent pulmonary vein isolation, which is, by the way, DECAAF did not mandate the type of ablation used in this study. So the physician could choose any type of approach, any type of catheter, balloon, non-balloon, radiofrequency, cryo, whatever they wanted. But we wanted them to ablate AFib. And they did an MRI before the procedure, looking at the fibrosis, and they would download the image to a centralized server called the DECAAF study server, with a core lab that analyzes the data and keep them blinded until the study is done. So at the end of the study, all this data were analyzed and disclosed, and we presented the data here at the Heart Rhythm Society meeting in Denver yesterday. So at the end of the follow-up, what we could show that from all the comorbidities that we have in DECAAF, so we had 331 patients. Out of these 331 patients, we could analyze 261, the patient who ended the follow-up and had good image quality and the MRI that we could use. From this patient, and after correcting again for all the comorbidities, hypertension, history of hypertension was the only predictor of the degree of atrial disease or atrial fibrosis in patients with atrial fibrillation. That's a very important finding. And as you know, for years, you know that hypertension is correlated in a way to fibrosis. To some, it's surprising. To others, it's not. For us, who's been dealing with this for years, wasn't surprising, but there was no correlation between the type of AFib, which is an important message to your followers on stopafib.org, that they should never, ever give up on their disease treatment and pursuing treatment of the disease. Always look before you treat. There was no correlation between duration and the type of AFib and the amount of fibrotic changes or disease in the atrium. Okay? Why this is important? Because in DECAAF we showed the more the atrium is diseased, so the more fibrosis you have, the less the chance of you staying in sinus rhythm if you undergo an AFib ablation procedure. That means the less the chance the procedure to be successful. Specifically, the fibrosis was the only independent predictor in the multivariate analysis for AFib ablation procedure outcome. For with a hazard ratio, with a hazard ratio of 1.063, meaning you have for every 1% of increase in fibrosis, you have 6.3% chance of practically having a chance of recurrence or chance of procedure failure. And what we also could confirm in DECAAF that based on the previously described UTEC classification or the staging of atrial fibrillation based on fibrosis or atrial disease, we could confirm that if you are in stage one or if you have less than 10% of your atrium disease, your chance of staying on sinus rhythm at 415 days follow-up in this multicenter DECAAF study, it's around 85%. If you have between 10 to 20% fibrosis on presentation to the ablation procedure, your chance of staying in sinus at 415 days after the procedure is 66%. And then you have 55% if you are between 10 to 30%. And if you have more than 30%, unfortunately, the chance of staying in sinus is very low, around 30%. So we are very excited, obviously, about this finding in terms of helping our patients and understanding when we sit down with our patient and talk to them. That's our expectation. Until now, we just go into the heart and then see what we find and do the ablation based on what we find in the heart. But now we can, before we go into that heart, number one, we can put our expectation with our patient, discuss it with them, said, this is great, you have a little disease, independent for how long you've been in AFib, independent of what type of AFib, independent of comorbidities, your chance of success is very high because you have a little disease, or your chance of recurring is very high because you have a lot of disease and you should either pursue other options or maybe take the rate control option or maybe, you know, try it, but the expectation is very low. So now finally we have a modality to understand what to expect from the heart with a simple 20 minutes an imaging tool, which is, you know, it takes us 20 minutes to finish the MRI and another 20 minutes to process the image. So all this together gives me an idea what to expect going in. As important from DECAAF, what we learned from DECAAF in this multicenter study, is that hypertension is an issue that we have to be, we all know mm-hmm. how important hypertension is. We all know how a very powerful risk factor for stroke and AFib hypertension has been. And now in DECAAF, we confirmed the association with tissue destruction or disease in the atrium in the AFib population. So we need to focus more and more on that hypertension, prevention of hypertension, hopefully to suppress the progression of fibrosis and atrial disease in our patient population, at least, you know, who are presenting with atrial fibrillation. So that's another important finding that we need to highlight in DECAAF. So I'm very happy and I'm thankful for everybody who participated. There's 15 centers, everybody was dedicated around the world, and you see if you look at the DECAAF patient population, distribution was equally distributed around the world. So we have European population, Australian, and then American, and then the data was independent from the center. If you do it in a high experience center or somebody who's doing 30 ablation a year, that was exciting as well. The outcome were the same
right.
in terms of recurrence. Well, the only predictor was atrial disease or fibrosis. It's very, very important. I mean, mm-hmm. we'd like to have this as a standard tool in every single center in the world. Mm-hmm. And hopefully soon, it seems this has been outsourced by the University of Utah to be adopted hopefully in every center in the universe. Every patient should, in my opinion, every patient, and I hope you agree with me as a Melanie Trueholz, mm-hmm. a major player in this field, an advocate for treatment and prevention, what I like about stop AFib, the prevention of AFib, mm-hmm. that we start promoting look before you treat concepts to get mm-hmm. patients early on before the disease too progressed.
Absolutely.
And to treat them or to avoid people that unnecessarily treated for AFib ablation. We have to accept the fact that there's some patients, some people we can treat, unfortunately, right. And we have to live with that. That's important. So it's important for us, and hopefully this will be adopted very soon after this multicenter study that the people have been waiting for.
Right.
4 years, as you know. This has been out there for a while, but now we need the multicenter study to prove the concept, and now it's there and it's been presented. This is good. So we are very, very, very excited about that.